say either, and you say either.
You say neither, and I say neither.
Either.
Either.
Neither.
Neither.
Let's call the whole thing off. I like potato, you like potato.
You like tomato, and I like tomato.
Potato.
Potato.
Tomato.
Tomato.
Let's call the whole thing off.
Hey, hi. How's it going, everybody? Welcome, welcome to the British American Experience. How you doing, Sarah?
Yeah, I'm good, thank you. Very happy to be here, and I enjoyed our dance quite a lot.
Me too. So, the first part of the show, let's put your guesses in the comments as to which one of us is British and which one of us is American.
I don't know how they're possibly going to guess.
I don't know. This is going to be a tough one, but you know, we got a pretty smart audience. I think they can do it.
Cool. So
British America.
Our show tonight will all be about kind of just playing in a very lighthearted way with the differences between our two nations. And for that, we've asked you for some suggestions kind of to get us started, which Brandon's going to talk about in terms of what we'd like from you. If you could pop that in the chat for us, please.
Right. So. We'll be exploring some cultural differences. So for one, for our first suggestions, we'd like to for you to name some traditionally American and traditionally British settings for a scene. So our British American cast is gonna make some scenes for you, and we'd like you to tell us where they're gonna be set. And we'll also be doing some discussions, and you'll get to see a panel, intercontinental, I guess. Yeah, intercontinental panel. Yeah. So if there's any questions you have for, if you're an American, if you'd like to know what those Brits are up to, if you're British and you'd like to know how we do on this side of the ponds, just drop those questions in the chat. Could be a specific question, could be a topic. You know, would you want to explain something? And we'll take it from there. So awesome. Yeah, welcome to the British American Experience.
Brandon, I've got a question for you. What is it that makes you an expert about America?
Great question. Great question, Sarah. You see, I live in America.
Oh, there you go.
Yep.
Yeah. So you know everything about America?
Nope, but I know what I've seen when I live here. So that's pretty much what I'm going to talk about.
Yeah, and same here. So what we're exploring tonight is completely just our own experience of our countries. And it could be quite specific, but it's just all coming from us in terms of our own personal experience. And we're aware, I guess, that there's a whole vast array of other experiences that are out there.
Personally?
Yeah.
I've never been to Texas. I don't know anything about Texas. So you're not going to learn about Texas in this show.
No questions about Texas, please. Thank you.
Yeah, please.
So I think let's bring our lovely casts on.
All right. Come on out, guys.
On you come, guys. Yay.
Hey.
Awesome. So I am going to introduce our lovely British cast. So first up, we have Julie Flower from Canterbury.
Oh, it's awfully nice to be here.
Thank you, darling. Thank you. And then we have Brendan from that there London town.
Isn't this spiffing?
Oh, he loves it, spiffing. And we have Fiona, also from London town.
Ah, much better.
She's an orphan from the musical Oliver. we also have Dan from London.
Don't know what English cricket is coming to.
And we have Vanessa from London.
Tea?
Cup of tea. She loves a cup of tea.
All right.
And I'm Sarah from Kent, I should say, in the UK. Oh, blimey, governor. Don't get many of them to a pound.
All right. Now let's introduce everyone from the US of A. First up, we've got David from Maryland.
What's up?
All right. Next up, we've got Brian from Maryland.
Hey, what's happening? I was trying to top David. I did bad.
Great, great. And please put your hands together for Jess from Maryland.
Hey, y'all.
And our ringer from far away, Jeff, from all the way in Maryland.
Hey, man, it's like really cool to meet you all.
And I'm Brandon from Boston, but I live in Maryland.
I'm seeing a theme.
All right. So awesome. Sarah's going to introduce the translation scenes.
Yeah.
Where we translate from English to English.
Yeah. So what you're going to see will be based on your suggestions that we were asking for kind of typical locations. So you'll see, first of all, a scene that's set in a typically American location with lots of American references. And then you will see the British cast attempting to reenact the scene with a British twist. And then you'll see vice versa. So what we need to get us started is just a location. So let's have a look at what we've got in the chat. Oh, we've got a bowling alley. That's interesting. I guess we do have those, don't we, in both countries. Bowling alley, have we got any other ones?
Not yet.
Cool. Not for an American. Bowling alley. Right. If you gave us bowling alley, you're amazing. Let's go with bowling alley.
All right.
Oh. You got the beers ready?
They're dollar tonight.
Oh, you know what that means. Drunk bowling. Drunk.
Otherwise known here in America as bowling.
You're right.
I really don't think I'm going to be on my game tonight, Jess.
What do you mean?
I got chili cheese fries in the hole of my best ball.
Oh no.
I can't get my fingers in there because it's filled with chili cheese fries, and I believe I'm not gonna win the midwinter spring league here. And I'm gonna have to wait for a championship until the sub-summer, early fall.
Oh,
regionals.
Brian, that's why I always tell you to stick to the nachos. They're easy to get out of the bowling ball. We've had that happen before.
I feel like I disrespected the French people back years ago, and I need to make up for that disrespect by eating fries.
Unseen. Now, let's see the perfect British reenactment of that.
Oh, have you got the sherries in, Brian?
Only a pound each.
What a bargain. We're going to have some tipsy bowling.
Just don't show them. Oh.
What?
There appears to be cheesy chips in my ball.
Brian, how unusual. What a strange cocktail snack tray.
I don't think this is a strange cocktail snack tray, darling. I think someone's trying to sabotage my chances of winning the autumn championships.
Heaven forfend, I can't imagine such a thing.
I have been the finest drunk bowler in this bowling alley 5 autumns in a row.
You certainly have, Brian, and nothing's going to stop you.
Oh, you know, I think it's because I've always gone out of my way to insult the French. That makes me the perfect Englishman. And people don't like me being too good at too many things. So I have to be bad at bowling.
Yes, that's true. I wonder maybe if you stick to a quintessentially English snack, like pork scratchings or salt and vinegar crisps, that might help.
That'll be the strength I need to score a strike.
Insane. Thank you so much, you two. Very, very accurate, I think.
Yeah.
Cool, so now we're going to move on to see it the other way around. Ooh, the magic of theatre. And we've got a great suggestion here, Brandon, for the British scene, which will be translated into American, which is, Oh, we've got a cheese shop or ye olde pub.
Ooh. Since I have no idea what a cheese shop is, I'd love to see that.
I see a cheese shop.
Ah, good Wensleydale.
That's fresh off the boat, that one is. Here, here, try some Emmental.
Yes, that's rich.
No, don't eat the product. Don't eat the product. We've got to sell that.
Sorry, I thought it was a free sample.
No, no, look, I brought you in here because, look, we're expanding, okay? Look, I thought, you know, ye olde cheese shop and pub was going to do all right, but frankly, we need to branch out our markets. And I just wanted to, you know, we wanted to do cheese boards and all that sort of thing. And we, frankly, your nose is the best nose in the cheese sniffing business. That's why I need you here. I need you to tell me what it is. If you eat it, that's going to get all your palate up, mate.
Yeah, you're right. I can't even smell the stinking bishop now. The most pungent of the cheeses.
Damn. It's fine. It's fine. It's just both of us keep calm. Here we go. It'll be fine. Look, here, have some baby bell. Maybe that will cleanse it. Try that.
Take the wax wrapper off.
Yeah, take the, yeah, don't eat that. Yeah.
Delicious.
Well, delicious? No. Oh, no, you really mucked it up now. Okay, fine.
Scene. Great. Wow, I feel like I know everything about cheese shops now. The only thing left to do is let's run this through the translator and see what that is in American.
Is that a good piece of American cheese there, David? It's because it's fresh off the truck.
Yeah, it's really good.
That piece of cheese was in Wisconsin 6 days ago, and it's been sitting on a truck unrefrigerated for 7.5 days. I didn't open the shop the other day.
Are you saying that I shouldn't have been eating it?
Oh, I'm just wondering, you know, like we here at the old cheese shop and bar, we're trying to combine, like, it maybe wasn't the best business plan to have cheese and beer. There's a lot of gas going on here.
Yeah, I admit I've been especially prone to it.
Oh, yeah. And I know with your highly refined nose, you smell all of that. Everything.
Well, yeah. And when I'm doing it myself, it's especially bad.
Oh, excellent. Excellent. Would you like some Polio string cheese?
Yes.
Remember to take the plastic off first. That's
Okay, I can totally eat this.
All right. It's just mozzarella cheese, but it's so much. It's like fun. It's like a game and a meal.
It tastes like a sort of like if you put mozzarella in a string form and then made it so you could kind of like play a game with it, like you said.
Yeah, it kind of takes the taste of the air around it. So it's starting to taste a little bit like farts.
See? yes, we're a very proud people, and we love to talk about farts.
I've learned so much.
Yeah, so I think you're getting it. You can basically totally pass for American now.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, I guess what we'll do next is Sarah and I have prepared some educational presentations. Mm-hmm. For you today. So you'll mm-hmm. learn a little bit about America, a little bit about the UK, mm-hmm. But specifically through the lens of stuff that we personally know about. Mm-hmm. So yeah, this isn't quite a documentary, but I think it'll be pretty educational. So
yeah, I feel like what's missing from improv is presentations.
Agreed.
We're bringing that back. So you'll see a presentation from each of us on a very specific thing, and then you'll see, so Brandon will do his first, and then the British cast will take inspiration from that to do about 8 minutes of improv inspired by it, and then we'll flip that over Okay, have fun, Brandon.
And today's theme is celebrations and holidays. And I am killing time so that I can share my screen. Hey, so holidays in America. This is, holidays that I like in America. There we go. I cannot, as an American, talk about holidays without talking about July 4th. I mean, that's the story of freedom. this is, as most of us know, when we gained our independence from the filthy British, we're looking at you guys. Not anybody, you know, present company excluded. You guys are great. But back in 1776, we had some disagreements. But today, it's all about three things: cookouts, fireworks, and beer. So let's start with cookouts. My favorite part is I like to call these supermarket cheeseburgers. I don't think anybody else does. But no matter where you go, where in the country, you can buy the ingredients for these cheeseburgers at any supermarket, anywhere, and they always taste exactly the same. And that's something that I think is beautiful. I've traveled around the country and every cheeseburger I have at a cookout basically tastes the same. You got the preformed burger patties that you buy from the supermarket already frozen. You got the white bread rolls that they somehow managed to get, you know, perfectly smooth. And we've got American cheese singles, individually wrapped slices of cheese, because thank you, American ingenuity. And the only thing you put on one of these burgers is just ketchup. Or I think in the UK it would be HP sauce, something like that. Fireworks are great. What not everybody might realize is because America is made up of 50 states, there's 50 different sets of laws, especially when it comes to fireworks. Where you live, what state you live in, has a big effect on whether or not you can celebrate 4th of July as our founding fathers intended. I grew up in Massachusetts, where sadly, almost no fireworks are actually legal, but we're very close to New Hampshire, where the smaller types of fireworks are legal. So every summer, there's a mass exodus right up to the New Hampshire border where fireworks are legal and there is no tax on liquor. So basically right here, you can just go right to gigantic fireworks stores and state-owned liquor stores, pack your trunk full of contraband and drive right back to Massachusetts and break the law. And the same thing, I had an internship in Kentucky, specifically Louisville, where some fireworks are legal. It's not quite as autocratic as Massachusetts, but Indiana has the best fireworks I've ever seen. You can get like this kind of stuff, and it's pretty much colorful artillery. I'm pretty sure I could take over Kent if I bought like 3 packages of these. And lest you think this is just, you know, some moderately sized package of fireworks, that's as tall as a person.
Oh my God.
And they literally, the advertising is, this is as big a firework as we're legally allowed to sell you. And of course, beer. Two biggest beers in America, Budweiser and Bud Light. Sometimes Bud Light is so popular, they call that Bud, and they call this one Bud Heavy. I actually have a can of America beer, because some summer, Budweiser decided to change its name to America as a marketing stunt. And it worked, because I bought a case. And in Maryland specifically, our beer of choice is National Bohemian Beer, or Natty Bo for short. And this is how much I love it. Moving on. St. Patrick's Day, my favorite. This is Shipping Up to Boston by the Dropkick Murphys. And I think St. Patrick drove the snakes out of Ireland. And I think that's a metaphor for pagans. I don't know. But basically, there's a couple of things you need to do on St. Patrick's Day. Drink beer. If you're me, play the bagpipes. And if you're from Massachusetts, listen to the Dropkick Murphys. They are a Irish rock band from Boston that plays songs almost exclusively about Boston. So whenever I hear one of their songs in a bar, I pretty much lose my shit because they're pretty much specifically tailored to me. And look, there's even a bagpiper right over there. One very specific, very local festival is the Toilet Bowl Races in Hamden, in the Hamden neighborhood in Baltimore. It's pretty self-explanatory, I think. You make a tricycle or some sort of wheeled vehicle out of a toilet and you race it. This one is especially fun. There's a NASA facility that runs the Hubble Space Telescope and soon to be launched James Webb Space Telescope. So they made a toilet bowl racer that looks like the James Webb Telescope that's going to be launched into space later this year. That's, I don't know, something you can't even make up. Great, thank you. If you have any questions, contact me at the sample text that I left in the presentation template. All right, Brits, are you ready to come on and do some improv based on that?
Yeah.
All right, have at it.
You want some mostly legal fireworks?
Yeah. What I really love is the nearly fatal Catherine wheel. Have you got one of those?
Sure thing. So you understand the rules that it will only kill people on Fridays. So that's how it works. That's how we can only legally sell it, is that it can only kill you on one day.
Yeah, perfect.
Do you want the almost blinding Roman candle?
Do you think I'm some sort of novice?
All right. Do you want the mediocre bang?
Go on then. Yeah. Look, gonna make the most of this weekend.
All right. What's going on here?
Mostly legal activities.
Good afternoon. I'm the almost policeman. Found a badge. Got to go with it. So,
mostly legal activity.
Fireworks, would they?
Almost certainly not.
No. Yeah, wow. 80% not.
I'm probably glad to hear that. Well, you just move along and we'll say almost nothing about it.
All right, we'll probably do that.
Yeah. Oh, I'm so glad we didn't have to give him like half a bribe.
Oh, not you. Look, don't listen to him. I've got something better. Would you like a human-sized sparkler?
I'm listening.
Yeah.
Tell me.
Go on.
What's the burn time on that?
72 hours.
And what's the length of hospital stay?
Well, yep. We don't talk about those things. It's legal in two states.
Yeah.
Cool. Yeah, I'm sorry. The deal's off. I want this sparkler. I'm sorry to have wasted your time. Nearly got us arrested. But 72-hour human-sized sparkler.
Yeah, I know when I've been beat.
Up to 72 hours later.
Well,
oh my god, it was beautiful. I just
edit. Yo, what is happening? Welcome to Pimp My Ball UK with me, Tim Westwood. Today we've got a brand new ball that's just coming. We're gonna have it on. Come on, my friends. Come on, I want to see your ball. Come on, don't leave Tim Westwood hanging. Fantastic. So what we got here, what kind of bowl we got?
I'll let my man speak.
I've got like a paper bowl.
Whoa, time out for tea dog. Are you saying you brought a paper bowl to a toilet bowl pimping show?
Yeah.
That's incredible. What ingenuity. I like you. Put you back in the shop. Great. What about you? What have you brought to Tim Westwood's Pimp My Bowl UK?
Well, my brother, I have brought you a giant chamber pot.
Mate.
Historic.
What is this? What a chamber pot? What do you think we are? The 1800s? Mate.
I think this is the past.
I thought,
He's got it. He brought a paper bowl. You know,
this is an antiques roadshow.
Yeah.
What's wrong about paper, mate? Hey?
Paper? It's recyclable. That's going to last around for another 100 years.
Well, this chamber pot, the urine inside that dates from King George III.
Now you've got my interest, mate. Now you got my interest. Tell me more about this urine.
Well, I'll if you just have a cup, and you will be able to see that is definitely royal piss.
Just so I've got this straight, you're asking me, Tim the Dog Westwood, host of Pimp My Bowl UK, to drink some urine that no one has tasted in 200 years?
I think we'd be able to goad him into it if we think he's not hard enough.
whoa. Hold your thoughts, paper bowl boy. I'm Tim Westwood. Cheers. There's
nothing Tim Westwood won't do.
Scene. Please, can somebody tell me if Tim Westwood is a real person?
Yes, he is. Yes.
Almost. Yeah, and
he's exactly like that.
Great. Wow. I've learned so much. So much. Well.
Cool. So now, there's just when you thought there were no more presentation fun to be had, there's more. And now I'm going to present on British holidays. Here we go. British celebrations and holidays. My caveats are this. In the limited experience of someone from a village in Kent with only 30 houses. So I would say our celebrations are quite niche. Disclaimer, there will be tea, and I'm really sorry about this, but there are going to be Morris dances. Sorry. here are some seasonal holidays or just furious reasons to have some time off work. What I think we've discovered about Britain is we have a lot more holidays than America, and particularly because I'm a teacher, I'm very much used to having like a 2-week holiday after pretty much anything. And a 6-week summer holiday and like a week in between. Teaching in Britain's quite hard. I think we might die if we didn't have them. everything is just punctuated by tea, I think, as you can see by this really accurate graph. May Day. So I'm going to talk about May Day, first of all, just because I think it's weird and it's worth talking about. So really... Really, it's only one day of the year. It's a bank holiday. We celebrate May. It's got lots of kind of pagan roots to it. These are people doing maypole dancing, which I have done myself as a child. You'll see that there's basically two rows of people. There's like an inner row and an outer row. And there's a pole, which probably is a phallic symbol. Let's be honest. It's paganism. There's a lot of trauma for me attached to May Day. So it's something we used to celebrate quite a lot at my primary school. So when I was young, you can see there's basically two rows of people, right? So there's an inside row and an outside row. But if, as some of the cast will know, I was just a gigantic child. So I essentially pretty much was the maypole. I don't know why they did this, but they put me on the inside row. So basically the children went round the maypole and wrapped me in the ribbons. So that's one of my memories of May Day. Moving on, the Green Man. I've just put him there because I showed him to Brandon and Brandon didn't know what to make of it at all. so again, he's a pagan symbol that's associated with May Day, bringing in of the spring and all those kind of things. Sorry, Morris dancers. there's a really old joke about why do Morris dancers wear bells so that the blind can suffer too. It's kind of dated but true. So in my village where I grew up, we had a lot of Morris dancing. We have them at Christmas as well. So they kind of dance outside the pub in our village and everything shuts down and the cars just have to have a massive traffic jam until they're done. They whack each other with sticks and they have bells on and they're just there to celebrate the spring. That was all a bit too exciting. I'm really sorry. If anyone does want to stop at this point and have a cup of tea, I do understand. I'm just going to talk about one more thing really quickly. Two things. Summer. So the summer holidays, obviously you can go somewhere really exotic. But if you are staying in Britain, a thing that was a feature again of my rural childhood was the country fair. So we'd have a big summer country fair and it'd be like the highlight of the summer. And everything about it in retrospect was really euphemistic. I don't know what to tell you. sheaf tossing is basically not as bad as it sounds. It is just a bale of hay that you put on a pitchfork and you try and get it over a goalpost that gets higher and higher. But these are the country kind of summertime pursuits that we went for. And finally, Christmas. So Christmas is quite a big deal in the village I grew up in. Still do actually when I go and visit, we go carol singing. So we go around everybody's houses, knock on the door, sing really, really badly. But what's great about it is every single person pretty much lets you in and they all spend the year brewing their own really, really violent kind of different types of gin. You basically go around all their houses eating mince pies and which are sweet, not savoury, and drinking gin. We also have this, which is the village mummer's play, which is from a medieval tradition, essentially. So it's King George fighting a dragon. This is in the pub car park because of our glamorous life. And that's a bit of tarpaulin that is the stage. And they basically, over Christmas, loads of people come to the village to watch this. And they do a really bad kind of Christmas play. And they get drunk and they whack each other with swords. It's very exciting. If you do want to have another cup of tea now, I would recommend it. Thank you. An American cast. I would love to see what you do with all of that.
I got great news.
Awesome.
We're going to do the Christmas pageant this year. We got the McDonald's parking lot. I booked the McDonald's parking lot. Last year we had to do it in the fucking Wendy's. I got McDonald's for the church Christmas pageant.
It bothers me that you're only checking at fast food restaurants. Are there other options?
Jeff, I look past the fact that your father was born in England, okay? I'm full American, okay? We're going to make this a Christmas to remember. We're doing it in a fast food parking lot. It might look a little dodgy. People might be dressed up. I mean, sure, the costumes may be bought on half price sale at the Halloween show. Last year,
everyone had red pigtails. They were all dressed up like Wendy. One person came as Dave Thomas, the founder of Wendy's. That was me.
Yeah, which you represented the baby Jesus. You were the one who brought everything for us.
Well, how does that make sense? Wendy's my daughter. Listen, okay.
Just please, can you get me a Grimace costume? Can you get me a Grimace?
I'm not going to tell you again, no. Easter was a disaster.
Oh, that's not my fault. That is not my fault, okay? Okay,
you chose to be the Hamburglar as the Easter Bunny, and you hid those burgers too well, and the whole town smelled like cheese for weeks.
Weeks, I know. I thought that the styrofoam containers would contain the smell. And it would, but it just ruined everything. And just don't remind me about that. We've got to look forward. McDonald's parking lot Christmas pageant. It's the epitome of class. It's the epitome of American invention.
Okay. All right. I guess I'll start hiding the chicken nuggets now.
Scene. Ding dong.
Yeah.
Deck the halls with boughs of holly. La 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 la.
Do you want some gin?
Oh, buddy, you're my 10th house. Gin on.
Okay, yeah. Another
roll. Sorry I'm late. Fa la 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 la.
I got it. You guys want some gin, right?
Yeah.
Okay, well, you don't have to keep singing. Like, I know what you guys really want.
But what if we want to keep singing and drink more gin?
Mm-hmm.
Oh.
You could be like, deck the halls with boughs of gin. Gin.
Okay, yeah.
All right. Sorry, you can't go down this street. We're having our yearly spring festival. There's a lot of people over there that are whacking things with sticks. They have knee pads on their thighs and they're tossing hay. So just move along.
Gross.
Not as bad as you think, actually. Like, hay tossing doesn't say, it sounds worse than it is. It just involves pitchforks and there's our head hay tosser, Jess Roby.
Oh, okay. Sorry, I just, it sounds weird, but I guess it's fine.
Old sport, do you want to try it?
Yeah, I want to try it.
Yeah, this is totally a festival where we hand weapons to people on the street.
It's fine. I'm 9 years old.
Oh,
okay.
Well, wait. Let me get you. You're big enough to use the full size pitchfork.
Yeah,
I did it.
Yep. Tag out David. Jeff, as head of the spring or summer festival committee, I just want to talk to you about some of the things that went wrong this year. Maybe we can improve for next year.
It wasn't as bad as you think. It's not as bad as you sound, really. I think that kid is going to bounce back.
I really hope so. I mean, why did you let him start with the small pitchfork? You should have just given him, once you put the small one in his hands, he thought he was okay with the small. No, just give them the biggest one first. Don't let them think they can't achieve their dreams.
Mm-hmm. Well, yeah. Also, if I'd given him the bigger one, he probably wouldn't have thrown it like a javelin across the county square.
Right into the dancers and
that's probably where impaled,
he impaled it. Three dancers on the tines, one on each one.
Yeah.
It was remarkable. Yeah.
It was too bad they weren't wearing their knee pads on their heads.
Yeah. But
so accurate.
Yep. I can, that's basically what happened to me last weekend.
There you go. Cool. So unbelievably, we are having to move on to our last bit of the show. Sad times. So this time we are going to do a living room format. So we're going to have a bit of a discussion about any questions that we have been given in the chat, and we'll go on to explore them. So Brandon, this is your little section to start with.
So come on into my living room, guys. we're gonna hash out some questions because people on the internet want to know some things. Oh, this might be one for the Brits. I've heard of this, but don't know much about it. But what is question hour? And apparently it makes normally polite British people turn American. Am I offended? Maybe.
This could refer to two things. There's Question Time, which is a show where a lineup of politicians and sometimes a random comedian talks about politics and takes questions from the audience. Or it could refer to Prime Minister's Question Time, which is when the Speaker of the House of Parliament chairs a debate between the Prime Minister and the Leader of the Opposition.
I think that's what it's referring to.
Yeah.
Oh, that's a shame, because I was going to say Boris is kind of like a celebrity, but not.
Yeah, he made his name in the comedy panel shows. It's basically debate. The Leader of the Opposition has six questions, and then the Prime Minister tries to answer them or makes no attempt to answer them. And it all happens every week regardless. There's no real consequences. Only the politic wonks watch the show.
Mm-hmm. We have a channel on cable called C-SPAN that is basically just unedited video streams of, you know, the House of Senate or Congress or like, you know, federal government meetings and whatnot. And nobody watches it either.
But the only times we would see anything from Parliament would be that. So that I think there are Americans who think that that is the full 100% time that is spent in Parliament, where the Speaker just comes and they yell at each other. And it is fascinatingly entertaining.
When the guy comes on and God damn it.
Yeah, I'm good.
Is that when the guy comes on and goes, order, order?
Yes. It's our Speaker of the House of Commons, who used to be someone called John Bursko, who he was great. He was there for many, many years. And again, I appreciate this will be lost on you as Americans, but he was from Yorkshire, so had a really strong accent and really one of the people. And every so often, but he would do it in such a polite way. He goes, Mr. Prime Minister, if you let the Leader of the Opposition, then why, you know, and all that sort of thing. But like, was really down and at times very passive aggressive. And beautiful. proper peak Britishness.
They don't call them by name. They have to say, the Honourable Gentleman, the Honourable.
All right.
If they're saying screw you, they have to be passack.
All right, let's go to scenes. Well, performance reviews are never my favorite time. And let's just get into it. All right.
Okay.
Now you're, as you know, we're doing much more statistically, you know, RPI based, metrics. So I'm just going to pull up a few. Your being a dipshit has increased by 33% this year. And your complete actually being a worthwhile human being is down from 50% at its peak to hovering above
11. I'm sorry, Brandon, I don't mean to speak out of turn, but according to the new rules, don't you need to, address me, say, respectfully, sir, you're being a dipshit. Is 38%. I think that's, that's just standard human resources behavior.
Yeah, you're right. You're right. HR is going to be on my ass about this.
Excuse me, the honorable gentleman from Boston and the honorable gentleman from Hanover. Mm-hmm. I had the Venn diagram of the amount of times that Brian or the esteemed gentleman from Pennsylvania, Brian, put his shopping cart back up in the front and when he put it in the corral and when he just left it in the space. So there's that data for you.
Great. Thanks. Yeah. Well, as you can see, in light of this new data, I'm going to have to respectfully ask you to pull your head out of your ass and do your job right.
Knock. Hello. Did you need a backbencher for this part?
Yes.
Brilliant. I'll just be here. Don't worry. Just carry
right,
on.
Right. So, we're implementing some new policies.
Come on.
Well, I haven't even talked about the policies yet.
You're doing great. Honorable gentleman, keep going.
Thank you. So we've transitioned to a new timekeeping software. We're going to give you new time cards. I bet you can do this better. You know what? Yeah. You know what? Go. Tell us how you'd do this.
Sorry, I'm the replacement. I've actually got a few other people who'd like to come do backbench and stuff. Guys, come on.
Oi. Sorry, you haven't started. Sorry.
Now, honourable gentleman from Hanover, we've had a couple of complaints about your constituency. Isn't that right, backbenchers? What have you got to say to your constituents here at the workplace?
Well, let me hear.
Who's the nerd?
You know, I feel like it's all been lost in translation. That I've you could say I have my head up my ass.
That's the best you got. Sorry, I'm backbenching for you now. You really need to stand up for yourself more.
I just want 2 weeks vacation. That's all. I just want 2 weeks vacation.
Two?
Work shy.
Lords and ladies of the House of Commons, addressing the nation, Jerry Seinfeld. What's the deal with institutionalized wealth? Not a fan. I'll now take questions. Please.
Jerry, the 1%, they're taking all of our money. What do we have?
Thank you, the honorable gentleman from Queens.
Representative Costanza here.
Honestly, I did not prepare any bits for this. I haven't done stand-up in quite a long time. And I'm really regretting making the journey.
Come on!
excuse me, I have a question for the honourable gentleman. My mother has been living in a council house for 20 years, and frankly, it is a disgrace. A disgrace, I tell you. Her pipes have been burst for ages. Now, what are you, the right honourable Jerry Seinfeld, going to do about it?
I just love your accent. It's just so, oh, my pipes burst. Oh, there's poop everywhere. It's so dainty.
Outrage.
Oh, I have another question.
Mr. Seinfeld, hello. Olivia here, Duchess of York. My question is to you. You know, we could take it back. Anytime. We could take your independence back. So I'm not threatening. I'm just saying I would consider possibly reconsidering your words about...
Tag out Jeff. Well... We did it. We got America back. Now it's all buggered up and we got to run the damn thing.
That's it, Jerry.
Awesome. So could I get the remaining cast on, please? And let's go and explore one more of the audience's questions. We have got a lovely one here that I think we could explore. What is a spanner and why does it end up in the works?
Isn't a spanner a particularly British thing? Do other countries not have spanners?
No, do you American
What is a spanner?
I think it's a wrench.
I've heard the word before, but I don't really know what it is.
Yeah, it like loosens a nut.
So a wrench.
Yeah,
there you go.
But like for us, a wrench would be a big thing, whereas a spanner can be a relatively small thing.
So a baby wrench.
It's like a little tiny, teeny one.
It's different sizes for different sizes of nuts.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, do you guys have different size nuts?
Yeah. I mean, relatively various sizes. Little bits, medium, small. So, I mean, it makes sense why you would need, like, you know, a baby one in a.
Yeah. And like, I can imagine it can end up in the works if you were spannering, which is a technical term, and you dropped it into the workings of a thing.
Right? Well, I'd imagine it's more, a deliberate act of sabotage, you know, when someone would try and break a piece of machinery by throwing a spanner into the works.
Yeah. Yeah.
Like You definitely have seen people throw spanners, wrenches, you know, I feel like that's something that people, frustrations. I remember one time
I was about to say something, but you weren't done. So
you go right ahead.
Throwing a spanner into the works.
So I just received like a, and I'm returning it because it's too hard to put together, and I'm about to move anyways. But I received a workout bike, and it's not assembled for me, and it's got like all these different parts, and then all these different tools, and I'm sure there's like what would be a spanner in there because. I can't put anything together, and neither, and everybody I've showed the instructions to like is confused by it. So
yeah, you've probably got a spanner, but you guys wouldn't say, like, if someone was playing up in a meeting, you wouldn't be like, oh, they've thrown a wrench in the works.
we would say that. Yeah, of course.
So I think let's see some scenes based on this scientific analysis.
Yeah, lots of hustle. I like it.
Are you sure you put this together properly? It's going very fast.
Yeah, I have a lot of experience putting these things together. I mean, I'm kind of an expert.
Loads of them. I notice you're not using any of them, though. It's just me.
Yeah, I can get on the treadmill. I mean,
that would be a great feeling of solidarity for me. I wouldn't feel so alone.
tag out David. Bob, can you not go any faster?
Oh, fine. I think I press this button.
Oh no, don't press that, don't press that. I forgot to tighten it with the spanner. maybe have a breather, Bob, because I think otherwise you are actually going to die. Here we go.
It'd be worth it. No pain, no gain. That's what they say.
Yes, I'm not sure we should have got this home biking system.
Oh, but David said it was all the rage. You should see how many he's got in his house.
No, but David's American and cool, and we're not.
Is there a kind of cool exercise we could do?
Hey, guys.
Hey, David.
I'm just walking around.
Why aren't we walking around? Quick, walk around.
Yeah, I was just letting you guys know that that I'm up to 6 miles now on my bike.
What? Oh, wow. 6 miles. All right.
Yeah, I got to go, though. I got to get back to my really cool life.
Bob, how are we ever going to be as cool as David?
He only lives 2 miles away.
I know. Oh, hey there.
Hey, you know how you're really into home gym?
Really into it.
Yeah, well, actually, I decided to just get a whole load of different balls. So I've got a table tennis ball. I've got a normal tennis ball. I've got a basketball.
Whoa.
And I've got, oh my gosh, I've got one of those big fit balls.
Wow.
Yeah. And depending on what size of ball.
Yeah.
Depends on what tool you need.
Wow, that is really cool.
It's amazing. It's
great. So have you got a tool for every size of ball?
Hell yeah. I mean, who'd miss that opportunity? This is America.
Wow, anything's possible.
Yeah. See? Hello. Thanks for joining the meeting. So here at Nutsy Farm, we're really trying to make sure that we have a variety of nuts, all different sizes, you know, from peanuts to big walnuts. Yeah. That's amazing.
Where should I put the coconut?
We weren't prepared for that just yet. The spacing, but no, I love it. Bring it back. Let me see. Okay. Yeah, that's probably the biggest nut that we have in our store currently. That's wow. Where did you get that?
Oh, well, I just the nut store in the next street.
Oh, so wait, you took a nut from another store
one of these nuts from?
To put nuts in our nut store.
Where did you want me to get the nuts from?
From a farm.
we have farms.
Yeah, there is nut farms. We literally tell our customers they're locally sourced, and I assumed that that was from farms, not from other nut stores.
You want me to go and ask the nut store in the next street where they get their nuts from?
I mean, do it discreetly. Don't think that, because we want them to know that we got our shit together too, you know? So do it discreetly.
Yeah. How about Jess? Yeah, we don't. Oh, hello, Robert. I'm just here polishing my nuts.
I've got a very discreet question to ask you.
Oh, discretion is always the name of the game when it comes to highly polished nuts.
Oh, I know. You swear by it.
Go on then, Robert. Is it a personal thing?
Well, it might be. I don't know how you'll take this. You might take it personal.
Oh. Go on, there's little that I've not heard about nuts.
Where do you get them from?
Do I need to explain the birds and the bees to you?
I thought you just sold nuts. I didn't know you sold birds and bees as well.
Oh, dear.
Where do you get those from?
Over in the next village. You're very naive, aren't you?
I was never told about the birds and the bees.
Well, you've got a lot of learning to do, my friend. I'm not sure I should be the one to break it to you.
Just come to deliver your nuts. Just come to deliver your nuts, love.
Thank you very much. You need to be a little discreet because I got company.
Oh, hi there. I'll just empty my trousers right here.
All right. Wow. Thank you so much. I feel like I'm just remembering President Woodrow Wilson, who promised a chicken in every pot and a nut of every size.
Wow. Quite a saying.
Wow, I think that's the end of our show almost.
It's the end of our show. Let's get all our costs back on.
Yeah, come on back out, guys. Wow. I had a great time. Learned so much. That's thank you so to all of our performers from both sides of the pond, and thank you for watching.
Thank you for watching. Howdy doody. Goodbye, y'all.
I like the and bugger off your wang.